Good morning, Lakeview Church. Boy, what a difference an hour makes. You should have seen the first service. They were coming in here two by two, screaming to get out of the rain. They looked like a bunch of animals scared, jumping on Noah's Ark. We are glad you've chosen to make this the service you came to. And whether you're with us in person, whether you're watching us online, or you're listening to our podcast later, thank you for making Lakeview part of your Sunday. We truly are honored to have you here with us today. My name is Sam. I'm one of the elders. And if you're here with us for the very first time, special welcome to you. Don't leave empty-handed. We actually have a bag of Lakeview stuff waiting for you just outside these side doors. Just all you have to do is let them know that you're new and this is your first week. They'll probably ask you to fill out a Connect card, or you can just take a picture of the QR code that's on the screen right now and fill it out in the comfort while you sit here. Today is Communion Sunday. Is there anyone that did not receive the elements when you came in? If you did not receive it, put your hand up high. We've got one over here. If we could get some over here, keep your hand up high. They'll make sure they get it to you. Linda, there we go, right next to you. Excellent. Thank you. We've got Lydia's Table prayer meeting coming up this coming Saturday at 8:30 in our Student Center. Wonderful time that our ladies get together and pray for our church, our nation, each other. Ladies, I think you'd really enjoy that. And then we've got a meet and greet coming up on the 18th between services. That'll be, I think, outside here on our prayer patio. I'm not exactly sure where it will be, but we hope it's going to be better weather. It gives you a chance to kind of meet some of the staff, some of the elders, ask some questions about Lakeview as you've been attending here. So that'll be on the 18th. Normally in our courtyard today, just outside these doors, we've got a few things going on. And in our lobby, we have a couple things going on. This is the last week for you to sign up for our Super Bowl party coming up on the 11th at 6 p.m. We're all going to watch Taylor Swift as she shows up. It'll be a good time. Do not clap at that. It'll be a good time, though. We're gonna have the game on. We're gonna have a chili competition. Do make sure you sign up so that we know how much food we need to have, and especially sign up if you're gonna participate in the chili cook-off. Mark Morse says he has a great recipe. I would like to prove him wrong. Someone else try to win that. So make sure you sign up today. It's your last chance. We also, last week, we introduced a brand new color T-shirt. It was like a heather purple. Believe it or not, we've got a denim blue available today. So we almost sold out of the heather purple last week. If you'd like either the green, the heather purple, or the blue, we're becoming an apparel company. Pick them up today. They're right outside this door as well. Lots of cool other things going on out there. We have our prayer boxes mounted in the lobby as well, and right next to those boxes are our prayer request cards. Your chance to fill those out with a request or a praise. You can put it in the box with your contact information on it if you'd like someone to call you and pray with you, or leave your contact information off and we'll pray for you anonymously. Either way, please take advantage of our prayer partners, the service that they offer. They'll be available for you following the service on either side of the platform as well as out at the prayer patio. We take it serious, so it's a great opportunity for you to spend some time with them. Thanks again for your continued giving. I really appreciate all the participation at the beginning of the year. God continues to bless us through your faithful giving. Thank you. You can do so here physically. We have collection boxes in the back of the sanctuary. You can also give online, mylakeviewchurch.com. If you do want to participate in our Burn the Mortgage campaign, somewhere on the check, write Burn the Mortgage. Preferably sign it, so don't write it there. And preferably make it out to Lakeview Church, so don't put it there. But, you know, on the lower left-hand thing, put it there. And we'll match that designated gift up to $100,000. We're excited because we want to get out from under these people. Not people. You get the point. Thank you. Thank you. I got one applause right here. Be good to your servers. They've been good to you. Okay. Appreciate the chance to welcome you all. We got some people still coming in this morning. Why don't you stand up, say hi to someone, and when you sit down, scooch in a little bit. Give some more room. Good morning. Thank you.
morning, Lakeview Church. Thank you for joining us. Even though it was rainy this morning, we're glad you're here. Will you turn and join us in worship?
Alone in my sorrow, dead in my sin, lost without hope, to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested, my life began.
Ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given.
Have made
place when the heart is under fire. Another way when the walls are closing in. And when I look at the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. There was another. All the time, whatever we go through, whatever battle, whatever tough circumstance, you are there, and you've shown us that through all of time. Help us to remember that today, Lord. We love you. Amen. You may be seated.
So excited. We have a special morning. Sarah, why don't you step here? OJ, family, Matt, and kids. If you don't know Sarah and Matt and the OJs, you should get to know them. They're awesome. For about the last month now, Sarah has been our new worship director here at Lakeview Church. I want to introduce her to you. Thanks, Sarah. So here's what I want us to do as a church. I just want us to spend some time praying over Matt and Sarah and their beautiful family. I want to invite up any elders we have here this morning, if you could come up. And I just want to spend a little bit of time in prayer over this precious family as they join our team on staff here at Lakeview Church. Will you join us in prayer?
Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for your love for us. And God, thank you for Matt and for Sarah and the kids. And God, we're very grateful for the leadership that you continue to move and direct in our way. We pray for Sarah as she leads us and takes us into those worship times. Thank you, Father, for Matt. And just pray that you continue blessing him. And thank you for Leo and Eileen, their family. And Lord, I pray specifically for their kids this morning as well. I pray for Avery, for Leo, for Charlie, and for Violet, that you would continue raising them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. God, I just pray that you'd put a hedge of protection around Sarah, and God, protect this family in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
What have I become, my sweetest friend? Everyone I know goes away in the end. And you could have it all, my empire of dirt. If I could start again, a million miles away, I would keep myself, I would find a way.
Well, good morning and welcome to Lakeview Church, where apparently nothing matters. We are... If you're just joining us, you picked a great Sunday to be here, I promise. My name is Tim. I'm the lead pastor here. We love going verse by verse through books of the Bible. We've come to the book of Ecclesiastes, and we're having so much fun in this joyful, positive, uplifting. Whew. So we're walking through this book. We've got our author, Solomon, who apparently the wisest fool to ever live. He's telling us everything is hevel. Over and over, we're reading this, right? Dozens of times we read this. It's meaningless, it's worthless, it's smoke, it's vapor, it's vanity. That's the idea of this word, hevel. Anybody experience a little bit of hevel this week? Maybe I'm just in Ecclesiastes too much, but like suddenly everything I do, I'm like, really? Why am I, what's the point? I was taking my daughter to school this week, and she's like, Dad, I'm like, what, baby? I'm on the treadmill. I'm like, yeah, I got to get up for school every day. Anybody feel that? You got to wake up every single day. She's on the treadmill. I got to share with you another hevel moment. I got a text from a Lakeview Church member this week, and she said, my husband and I were playing upwards this game, and we were chasing after the wind for hours. She said, we're chasing after the wind for hours. I got up. I was winning like crazy, she said, but I got complacent. Suddenly, my husband caught up to me in the end, and after hours of gameplay, it ended in a tie. All is hevel. Right? Is there anything? Beware, if you text me your hevel moment, it just might make it into the sermon next week. Just throwing that out there. We wrapped up Ecclesiastes chapter 1 last week, and we discovered this guy Solomon, he's kind of on a quest. Right? He is both the scientist and he's the subject, and he's doing what a lot of us are doing right now. He's trying to find meaning. Anybody there? Like, you want to know what's the point? Why am I here? Does anything matter at all? That's the quest this guy is under. I want us to pay attention to this quest because Solomon is going to do something we will never be able to do. He's going to exhaust all options. Okay? We will not have the resources, the finances, the means to do what Solomon has already done. He's able to go for it. He's able to test everything And he's going to come back with his answer. So the end of chapter 1 sort of sets up Solomon's testimony. And then beginning in chapter 2, he's going to give us the details of this search. Like, he's going to get into the details of some very specific things this guy tried to find meaning. We're going to have a long list here, and I promise we're all going to get covered, okay? All of us are going to be in this list somewhere in our search for meaning. He leaves no one out. So if you have your Bibles, open with me to Ecclesiastes chapter 2. We're going to start in verse number 1. Here's what Solomon says. He said, I said in my heart, come now, I will test you with pleasure. All right, what feels good? I'll test you with pleasure. Enjoy yourself. Then he's going to give us the answer before he even gets into the details, right? But behold, this also was vanity. Tim Keller points out something interesting here. He says this. He says, it's not until Solomon already concluded that there are no answers in life that he then turns to pleasure. You kind of get that? If there's no point, might as well enjoy it, right? If there's no point, bring on the fun, baby. Let's go for it. Let's have some fun. Let's do this thing right. If nothing else matters, I'm going to lighten up. I'm going to laugh a little bit. I'm going to enjoy life. And it's interesting to me that before he gives us these details, and he's going to give us the details of exactly what he attempts in order to find pleasure, before he even does that, he says, just so you know, I've already got the answer. Hevel. Right? Just so you know, the answer is here. It's vanity. Was anybody a good math student in school? I wasn't that good at math. I could get the right answer, but here was the problem. I'd get the answer right. I'd get the test back, and guess what? I got marked off 5 points. Why? I didn't show my work. Like, come on, who cares? I got the answer right. Why do I have to show my work? Here's what Solomon's going to do. Solomon's going to show us the work. He's already given us the answer. We don't believe him. He says, okay, then I'm going to show you my work. I'm going to show you how I got to this answer. So, Solomon, are you sure pleasure is hevel? He says, here, let me show you my work. Verse number 2. I said of laughter, it is mad. And of pleasure, what use is it? Anybody like to laugh? Me too. Right? There's nothing wrong with laughter. I enjoy laughter. Matt Ogier enjoys laughter. He enjoys making people laugh. We should enjoy laughter. It's a good God-given gift. But Solomon says, you know what? I've heard people say that laughter is the best medicine when I'm feeling down. So I'm going to go for it. I'm going to go all in on laughter. So he goes all in. He does whatever he can. He binge watches all 9 seasons of The Office. He has a Will Ferrell movie marathon. He brings up the best stand-up comics you could possibly imagine. He's got Nate Bargatze. He's got Jim Gaffigan, Pete Holmes, Zach Galifianakis, Sarah Silverman, Dave Chappelle. The dude brings in the funniest people on the planet, and he laughs until his belly hurts. Like, he laughs and he laughs and he laughs. But does it solve the problem? Look, I'm not against laughter. I am all for laughter. I mean, one of the reasons I fell in love with my wife was her laugh. Like, being able to make her laugh and see her smile, like, that brought so much joy and brings so much joy to me. A lot of us enjoy our times of laughter with our friends and with our family. So I want to be careful here, because we're going to go through this list, and some of you are not Christians, and that's fine. I'm stoked that you're here. I'm going to tell you about this guy. His name's Jesus. He's awesome. But some of you come and you're like, okay, here we go. He's going to give me the list of all the stuff the world has to offer, and he's going to tell me they're all bad and they're all sin, and Jesus wants me to have no fun, right? And God's this, like, tyrannical fun killer. That's his job. Cosmic killjoy. If you enjoy life, you're going to burn. I don't know when this set in. Like, this is a dumb concept. Do you know who created pleasure? It wasn't you, it was God. Do you know who created fun? It wasn't you, it was God. Like, think back to the very beginning. This is how I know this. God created a man and a woman, and they're both butt naked in a garden, and he says, go for it. Pretty good God, right? He says, be fruitful and... what does that mean? I don't know. The parts make sense. I'm telling you, God is not some cosmic killjoy, right? He's not. The issue is when we take pleasure and we take fun and we elevate it to everything. That's the problem. This is what Solomon tries to do. He tries to take the gift of pleasure and the gift of fun that God has given us. And he says, I'm gonna make this ultimate. I'm gonna make this everything. Is that going to satisfy me? No. No. Solomon's gonna come back. He says, look, laughter's not a bad thing. It's just not everything, okay? It's not everything. Anybody ever heard a baby laugh? Like, is that not the best? Like, you get a baby tickle and you're like, this is just, like, you can't help it, right? Like, grandparents in the room, you know what I'm talking about. Like, it's the sweetest thing. This is how I know we serve a great God who loves to laugh. He probably laughs at me a lot. Solomon says, look, it's a good thing, but it's a distraction. Right? Laughter can be a temporary distraction from this treadmill of life that we're currently on. So laughter doesn't work. How about this? Some of you are here. Some of you remember these days. It's almost like we're going through some phases of life here. He says, laughter, it doesn't work, but don't think God's a killjoy. Okay? I want to make sure we understand this because heaven is not some eternal trip to the dentist, right? That's not heaven. Heaven is going to be awesome. We're going to enjoy it. We're going to have a ton of fun. Here's what Solomon says. Laughter didn't work. Still got issues in here. Verse number 3. He says, I searched with my heart how to cheer my body with wine. Here we go. You're like, oh, he's going to talk about alcohol. What's he going to say? Now, you were just waiting on this for me to pick out whatever that thing is. Like, I'm not going to go there. I'm not going to get into this debate that Christians have had for a long, long time. I do find this one funny. The next line in the verse is, my heart's still guiding me with wisdom. So there are some pastors who will say, see, Solomon drank responsibly. Give me a break. Like, come on. Have you read 1 Kings? The dude knew how to party. Like, that was his life. Like the ultimate party. So yeah, he probably did try to join like the fine wine club of Jerusalem and he enjoyed all the fancy stuff, but he also just got down and crazy, right? Like absolutely crazy. He says, how to lay hold on folly till I might see what was good for the children of man to do under the heaven. Super positive Solomon, here he goes, during their few days of their life. So Solomon's quest for meaning, some of you can get this one because you've been there, you're here right now. His quest for meaning led him to throwing the most epic parties you could ever imagine. Like the most epic, I'm talking extended parties, not just like once a week, once a month, once a year, but we know, again, 1 Kings, day after day after day after day after day. We don't know how long these parties lasted, how long the party scene lasted, but I guarantee you it was longer than your party scene. And I'm telling you, his parties outnumbered any party you've ever been to. We read in 1 Kings that he had enough food, get this, he had enough food to feed 15 to 20,000 people every single day. Every day, right? More people were showing up to this guy's parties than show up to Tropicana Field for a Rays game. You're like, that's not a big deal. It is a big deal. And you're like, okay, like he knew how to party, but did he know how to party, right? Because you're like, you're thinking back to yours. You're like, man, that kegger was epic. Like, my backyard barbecue is pretty awesome. We had a bring your own meat fest. I'm just telling you, your bachelor party, your bachelorette party, your frat parties compared to Solomon were preschool, okay? Serious. Like, you could not touch this level of partying. Solomon's level of partying is beyond anything you could ever imagine. Wild. He would look at our parties and make fun of us. Remember, this guy had unlimited resources. Unlimited. Money wasn't a thing. It didn't matter. He just spent it. That was the life of Solomon, lacking no resources. So can you imagine if anything or anyone could be yours at any time? Solomon didn't imagine it. He lived it. He lived it. So this was his life for a period of time. And eventually he's like, you know what? I need to make something of myself. Like, note these, like, stages of life. I find this fascinating. So he goes on from the party scene. Doesn't really leave the party scene. We're going to get to that in a little bit. He still parties a bit, but he tries some other things, too. So he's going to try to make a name for himself, and he goes into like this building phase where he's going to establish himself. And there's like this sense of permanence that we're going to get here from what Solomon's about to do. So check out verses 4, 5, and 6. Solomon says, I made great works. Right? I built a house. I built houses. I planted vineyards for myself. We also know that he built houses for all his wives, 700 of them. The dude knew how to build. Verse 5 says, I made myself gardens and parks. Anybody love nature? You love getting out in the yard? Get this. He says in verse 5, I planted in them all kinds of trees. Verse 6, I made myself pools from which to water the what? The forest. The forest of growing trees. Right, you've got that planter's box, and you got that raised garden. That's cute. How about a national forest in my back 900 acres? Like, that's Solomon, okay? That's Solomon. Solomon did that. Like, there's this sense of pride. I mean, you remember when you first became a homeowner, it felt good, right? You signed on the dotted line, you were given the keys, and there's like this sense of permanence and pride. And Solomon's like, I tried that a couple hundred times. Tried that. And Solomon's like, I didn't just plant a garden, okay? I literally planted a national forest. Again, this is like the master of one-uppery is great here. Like, there's nothing you can do that he hasn't already one-upped. Right? No matter what we've tried, he's tried it even greater. Like, anything we can do, he can do better. Right? And he did. To this day, some of you know this, if you were to go to Jerusalem, just southwest of Jerusalem, you'd see these craters in the earth. You can Google this. There's actually pictures of it. There are these craters in the earth, and you know what they're called? The pools of Solomon. They're still there. Solomon dug these massive holes in the earth to water the gardens, the national parks, and the national forests that he planted. Like, the dude made a name for himself. Some of the stuff he constructed, still there. Like, can you imagine this lifestyle? I can't. Like, it's beyond my ability to imagine this. Like, it is so extravagant. Do you love nature? Your backyard's a national park. It's all yours. You got a personal lakes. You got orchards, vineyards. The dude was the ultimate gardener. Any green thumbs out there? Any interior designers out there? He was a master at that too. I mean, what if your build, in your build, money wasn't an issue? How big would your house be? How big would your yard be? What about that dream landscape? Maybe this is kind of how you think. If I just had that house in that neighborhood with that amazing yard on the cul-de-sac, on the water, like then, right? Like then I'd be happy. Get this. Solomon was debt-free. Some of us, that's our goal. Like, that's it, baby. Like, man, if I can just get out from these credit cards and this mortgage and all these loans, like then, like once I'm debt-free, Solomon's like, try that. I still have problems. Sorry, Dave Ramsey, didn't solve it. Still love you, Dave. So Solomon goes from this building phase where he's built everything you could imagine. It's a whole city. Like, he's literally built an entire city for himself. Doesn't satisfy. So then he moves into this other phase where he kind of just enjoys what he already has. This sort of enjoyment phase of life. Maybe some of you are there now. Right? You've worked really hard, and you're like, you know what? I'm just going to enjoy what I have. That's Solomon here, verse 7. Here's what he says. He says, I bought male and female slaves and had slaves who were born in my house. Here's what he's saying. I never lifted a finger. Ever. My slaves had slaves, and their slaves had slaves, and their slaves had slaves, and every slave existed to serve me. So I'm going to do whatever I want, whenever I want, and how long I want. I'm going to sleep in. My personal chef is going to take care of breakfast for me. I got a mani-pedi at noon. I'm going to hit that up. I got a 2-hour massage. It's going to be great. Every day. Whatever he wanted to do. Everything was done for this man. This is really hard for us to grasp, but he had, according to scripture, thousands upon thousands of personal staff members. Thousands. They existed for one purpose, to serve him, whatever he wanted. So what if there was no limit to the amount of people you could hire to do anything and everything for you? Would that work? Would that solve the problems going on in your life? Would that fix that loneliness, that emptiness, that longing that we all have for something more? Would that work? He keeps going in verse 7. He says, I also had great possessions of herds and flocks, more than any who had been before me in Jerusalem. This is ridiculous. It's over the top. The dude owned a zoo. What? Like, he's at his own zoo. Any animal lovers out there? In the ancient world, wealth and power were often held in the animals that you owned. I'm telling you, this guy had every exotic animal you could possibly imagine. 1 Kings chapter 4 tells us that Solomon had 4,000 stalls for chariot horses. 4,000. Which means he had over 12,000 horses. Unbelievable horsepower, guys. Any car lovers out there, right? Chariots at that time would be the equivalent to your vehicle, and Solomon had an unlimited supply. He didn't have a garage full of cars. He had garages full of exotic cars. Any mode of transportation he had. The rarest, the best, the most expensive. So would this do it for you? Would owning a zoo and thousands of cars, would that satisfy the longing in your heart? Solomon says, no, it doesn't. I'm going to show you the math. And you're thinking, well, what about money? What about money? There seems to be this idea, especially here in America, that if I just had a little bit more, that would fix everything, right? If I just had a little bit more on my paycheck, and you know, I don't want to live extravagant. I just want to be able to pay my bills. I want to be able to feed my kids. I want to be able to send them to school. If I just had a little bit more, then everything would be solved. Does that work? Let's find out. Verse 8, Solomon says, I also gathered for myself silver and gold and the treasure of kings and provinces. I'm just going to tell you right now, Solomon never made a budget. Solomon never needed to keep an account for how much he was spending. He didn't need an envelope system with cash. There was no limit to the man's money. Like, literally the richest man in the history of the world at this time. Like, you couldn't touch this kind of wealth. 1 Kings chapter 10 tells us that the queen of Sheba, who was a very prominent figure at the time, big deal herself, she actually came to visit Solomon, and the amount of gold she brought doesn't even make sense in our minds. Literally, shiploads, cargo loads full of gold. Solomon reigned for about 40 years. It was 40 years of prosperity. The gold was flowing freely. They overlaid everything in gold. 1 Kings also talks about Solomon's throne, which is just insane. Dads, do you have a chair? Yet that chair, you know, no one else sits in it. That's my chair. That's my lazy boy. It reclines. I'm going to tell you right now, your chair doesn't touch Solomon's chair. It was overlaid with gold. There's a sweet description of it. I know sometimes we get like bored with the history books, but there's some good stuff in there. Six steps were required to get to this man's chair. This is the ultimate dad chair, guys. His wealth was so insane, scripture tells us silver became worthless. They're throwing silver out in the streets because who needs it? We got gold, baby. Unlimited supply of gold, 40 years of prosperity, unlimited riches. How many of us believe that, man, if I just had a little bit more money, then my problems would go away? But we all know the drill, more money, more problems. Solomon says no. Okay, what about art? Anybody love music, musicians, bands, artists, artistry, all things art? Solomon says, maybe that will solve it. I'm gonna devote myself to the arts. Maybe this will bring me satisfaction and meaning and purpose. Some of you are there, right? You love the idea of this, of just diving into your art, your craft, your music. Maybe this will solve that longing in my heart. Look at verse 8 continuing. He says, I got singers, both male and female, both men and women. Here's what Solomon says. Solomon says, I don't need Apple Music. I don't need Spotify Premium. I don't need Amazon Music Unlimited. If I hear a band that I like, I buy them. So that's what he did, literally. He bought the band. He bought the band. He'd bring them into his palace, and they would play for him anytime he wanted. Can you imagine being able to afford your favorite artist of all time? Oh, you scored Taylor Swift tickets. That's cute. Taylor just played All Too Well, the 13-minute version, for me while I was in the shower. Okay? That's Solomon. That's Solomon. Whatever he wanted. Whenever he wanted it. Best bands, you got it. Best artists in the world, they come to him. Solomon did not have to imagine it. He lived it. This is wild. Okay, here we go. We all knew this was coming. This is kind of what he was known for, right? Like, everyone's like tensed up here. Like, what are we going to talk about? Solomon was known for his love of women, okay? There's no secret there. I told you, 700 wives, 300 concubines. Continuing in verse 8, and many concubines, the delight of the sons of man, your translation might say, everything a man could desire. Men have fantasies. Solomon had realities, okay? Thousand women existed to pleasure him. Is sex your struggle? Ladies, this could apply to you. Imagine 1,000 men in perfect shape exist just to serve you anytime you want. Right? It's hard to imagine this, right? 1,000 people, literally this is their job day and night. This is it. They were paid to do this, to look their best, to be at their best, and to always be ready for whatever and whenever at any time. This was their only job. These women would live in various places in Solomon's houses, and any men that worked near them were more than likely castrated. So, oh, by the way, no one else is touching these women except you. Do you think if all of your fantasies became your realities that you would be fulfilled, that you would be satisfied, and you would be complete? I'm telling you, Solomon tried that too. He tried it. Every sexual fantasy possible. It's easy to read this and think, wow, Solomon was like kind of bad. Like, that's crazy. Like I would never have access to 1,000 women like that. Yeah, well. Thanks to technology, the amount of women you choose to degrade, dehumanize, and objectify could possibly outnumber Solomon's women in a single day, and you know that. So if there were no restrictions on your sexual life, would that be everything you need? Solomon says, I tried that one too, I got the t-shirt, I came back, it doesn't work. Still didn't work. Okay. Like, if that doesn't work, like, what could possibly work? How about fame and popularity? How about, like, the ultimate celebrity? Verse 9. He tried it. So I became great. I became great, and I surpassed all who were before me in Jerusalem. Solomon became the most popular man on earth. No one could touch this guy. By far, more followers on TikTok, Instagram, X than all of us combined. Any celebrity out there you could possibly imagine, he was more popular than them. Okay, more subscribers on YouTube than Mr. Beast, Ryan Trahan, and Cocomelon. The dude built the ultimate platform. Okay, some of us live for this. We live for the likes and the clicks and the comments and the shares and the subscribers. Solomon said, been there, done that. Doesn't satisfy. Had it all. He was the influencer of influencers. And scripture tells us that the famous and wealthy in this day would visit Solomon. So it's kind of crazy to think about. Politicians have to go out on the road. Bands have to go out on tour. Not Solomon. He didn't have to go anywhere. Everyone came to him. That's how popular he was. I mean, do we have to ask this question? Do we really have to ask if fame and popularity are the answer to life's quest for meaning? Like, I don't know if we need another biopic or another music documentary, right? You've seen enough of these. They all play out the same way, right? The celebrity, the athlete, the artist, they came from nowhere. They rose to the top. They became known by everyone only to realize that having everything led to more loneliness and emptiness than ever before. Fame is not the answer. Popularity is not the answer. So maybe you're thinking, look, money's not my thing. Sex, fame. What about education? What about education? That seems like a noble quest, right? To absorb all of the knowledge you possibly could. Solomon says this in verse 9, also my wisdom remained with me. Solomon tried this too. So you got to imagine not having a job, no chores, and you could devote all of your time to just acquiring more and more knowledge. You could have the greatest library in your home. You could hire the best teachers, the best professors, the best scholars to literally come in and give you a private session to teach you everything. And here's the thing. He had a superhero ability to retain everything. It was wild. Scripture tells us that God asked him, you know, what do you want? I'll give you anything you want. Could ask for anything. He asked for wisdom. So he has this ability to retain all of this. I told you a minute ago about the Queen of Sheba. She didn't just come to bring him gold. You know the story? The Queen of Sheba also came with a very skeptical mind. The Queen of Sheba had heard, this guy Solomon, he knows it all. Really smart, really wise. So she said, I'm going to go test this guy. All right, you can read about this in 1 Kings chapter 5. She puts him on Jeopardy, okay? Tournament of Champions. He's going up against Ken Jennings. Right, does he have it? I was a big Jeopardy fan. Does he have it? Like, does he have what it takes to master this tournament that she's going to put him through? And get this, he gets every question right. Like, flawless victory. He got a 1600 on the SAT. He got a 36 on the ACT. He got a 400 on the bar exam. He got a 528 on the MCAT, and he got an 800 on the GMAT. He nailed it, right? Everything you threw at him. The queen was blown away. She was blown away. That's Solomon. Now, can you imagine if Elon Musk shows up at your house to pick your brain on robotics, human brain implants, and the future of space exploration? Imagine the greatest minds on earth coming to you for advice. That is Solomon. I'm trying to drive this home because there's nothing you can do that he hasn't already tried. That's the point. Some of you are reading this and you're like, oh, I'll go out on a quest. This sounds like a good idea. I shall start mine tomorrow. No. You don't need to go on a quest because we don't need the sequel to Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiastes has already been written. That's the point. He tried everything. Everything under the sun, it has already been tried. And some of you are still thinking, not me. My thing hasn't been listed. None of those things entice me. Okay, tough guy. How about this, right? Verse 10. And whatever my eyes desired. And whatever my eyes desired, I did not keep from them. I kept my heart from no pleasure. Solomon says, I denied myself no pleasure. Maybe you're thinking, well, he didn't try this. Yes, he did. This is the junk drawer, okay? It's all in there. You might not be able to find it, but I promise it's there. So he says, it's all there. Like, this is the proverbial everything you could possibly think of, humans, I tried. I searched for meaning in this thing. You name it, He tried it. Cooking, baking, reading, pets, video games, outdoor activities, traveling, DIY, arts and crafts, socializing, board games, card games, gardening, plants, meditation, wellness, exercise, photography, tech, computers, cars, vehicles, sports, fitness, writing, music, art. I just Googled the top 20 American hobbies, like that was it. Right? Literally. Whatever your thing is, I'm just telling you, Solomon tried it. He absolutely tried it. There was never a day where I said no. Can you picture this? And on top of that, no one ever said no to me. What about work? Maybe you enjoy your work. Maybe you found a great job. And you're like, you know what? I actually enjoy going to work every day. Maybe for some of you, you're like, if I could just find that perfect job. Look at the second half of verse 10. He says, for my heart found pleasure in all my toil, and this was my reward for all my toil. Maybe a good hard day's work. Maybe that's the answer. And I don't know what you fill your time with. Maybe you're retired and now you're volunteering, and that's kind of how you spend your time, coaching youth sports. Again, I'm telling you, Solomon's covered all the bases here. Sometimes we think, you know, how awesome would it be to get that perfect job, right? To like have the job that I enjoy getting out of bed for every single morning. And if I just had that, maybe that's what would fix the brokenness inside of me. And Solomon says, no. Did he enjoy these things? Yes. Like, let's not be ignorant Christians. Like, that just drives me insane. There's a reason sin is enticing, because it's fun for a season. There is a sense of enjoyment and satisfaction, but I'm telling you, as Solomon is telling you, it does not last. You are going to be looking for the next thing once that thing wears off. Verse 11, Solomon says, then I considered all that my hands had done and the toil I had expended in doing it, and behold, all was what? All was vanity. Striving after the wind, there was nothing to be gained under the sun. Maybe you're thinking, yeah, but I've got a plan. I've got a 10-year plan, right? Like I'm gonna accomplish these goals. I'm gonna get after it. What's gonna happen in about, I don't know, 10 years? Well, you've probably forgotten about that 10-year plan and you've already started your next 10-year plan, right? You're gonna go another 10 years. And you're going to go another 10 years. You're going to go another 10 years. And maybe, if you're lucky, you'll go one more 10 years before you're painted up like a clown and buried in a box. That's what Solomon's getting at here. Until we have no more time left on earth, we think, this is like classic American thinking, like if I just had one more thing. Really? Really, what you want is more of what you already have. And you think if you have more of that thing, then you'll be satisfied. Solomon says it's vanity. It's vapor. It's like trying to establish a wind collection. Let's just be really honest here. Like, we don't buy out of need, okay? Like, your jeans did not disintegrate last night. That's not why you went out and bought a new $90 pair of jeans that was already partially disintegrated. Like we just think we need more. Maybe if I buy a little more, then I'll have some enjoyment in life. And we do this. Like, insert whatever that thing is here. I'm not satisfied with who I am. I'm going to become someone else. Maybe then I'll be satisfied. We try to numb the boredom in our lives by acquiring more and more and trying more and more and trying to fill our lives with more and more. Solomon got to the end of his goals and the end of his acquisitions, and he said it's meaningless. So this is my fear for us, Lakeview Church. My fear for us is that we will spend the rest of our lives chasing after the wind, chasing after nothingness. Chasing after more of what we already have in search of happiness and satisfaction and fulfillment, only to die on the treadmill. There has to be more, right? There just has to be. Like, there has to be more. Solomon knows there's more. Right? Wisest dude on earth at the time, I'm telling you, he knew there was more. So we're going to get to this in a couple of weeks, but Ecclesiastes chapter 3. Solomon says that God set our hearts on eternity. I just want us to think about the implications of that for a minute. God set upon our hearts eternity. And so I want us to think back to the beginning, the very, very beginning. God created man and woman. They were created perfect in the garden. There was no sense of loneliness or missing peace in their lives. It was perfect. So sin entered the world, Genesis, fractured everything. I believe that deep, 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 deep down in our souls, we know that we are here for something greater. Like, there is a longing, and I haven't met anyone that would deny this. Like, there's this thing, I don't know what that thing is, right? It's like this chasm, it's this crater. And we're trying to fill that thing. That's what we try to do every day. We try to fill that thing for belonging, for purpose. Like, and we think, maybe if I just had a little bit more I could stuff in there, then I'd be happy, then I'd be satisfied, then I'd have all that we need. Here's what I want us to do. I want us to fast forward about 1,000 years after Solomon. 1,000 years after Solomon, Jesus is walking the earth. There's this incredible story. It's recorded in John chapter 4. I don't have time to dive into the whole thing, so I'm going to paraphrase a little bit for you. It's an amazing story. Jesus has this conversation with a Samaritan woman at the well. Are you familiar with this story? A couple of red flags here right off the bat. Scripture tells us that Jesus decided to go through Samaria, which he didn't have to. He chose to. Major red flag. Jews and Samaritans do not mix. They don't mingle. They don't get along. They hate each other. Okay, it's about the middle of the day. Jesus comes across this woman at the well. This is another major red flag, okay? You've got Jesus and a woman. Hello, Billy Graham rule, violated. This woman is well known among other women. She does not have a good reputation. At this point, she's basically selling her body for rent money, which is why she's at the well in the middle of the day and not early in the day, which was typical of when you would draw your water. She didn't want to be seen by anyone. She didn't want the other women to make fun of her. She's embarrassed. She doesn't want to be noticed. But guess what? Jesus sees her. This wasn't an accident. This wasn't chance. This was a divine appointment. Jesus asks her for a drink, and she's like, but you're a Jew. I'm a Samaritan. This is probably not a good idea. He's like, lady, if you knew who you were talking to, you'd actually be asking me for a whole lot more. And she like completely misses the point. She's like, you don't even have a cup. How am I going to give you water? But listen to what Jesus says. Don't miss this. Jesus says this in John chapter 4, verses 13 and 14. Jesus answered, everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. That's Solomon, right? He's drinking from the wells of this earth and anything and everything. And let's be honest, that's us. That's our story. And we're constantly thirsty. We're never satisfied. We're never filled. Then Jesus says this in verse 14, but whoever drinks the water I give them will what? Will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them. This is pretty cool. Listen to this language. Will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, Solomon says, our hearts are set on eternity. 1,000 years later, Jesus comes and he says, I am the eternal one that your hearts are set on. Like, this is the answer. Jesus says, I am eternal. Jesus says, I can fill that void. That momentary pleasure, that thing, more stuff, it's not gonna work. I will. Jesus tells this woman, all those men that have taken advantage of you, all the people who belittled you, all the places you went to try to fill that longing in your soul, all those things, and you know these things because they leave you with shame and guilt and emptiness. Jesus says, it can be over because I fill that longing that you have. That desire you have for meaning and for purpose and for satisfaction. I want to kind of debunk another silly thing we do as Christians. I think it's just kind of foolish. We'll often say, you know, well, if you want to be a good husband or a good father, you have to be a Christian. I've actually known some really good husbands that weren't believers. I've known some really good dads that weren't believers. What I will say is this: we won't understand what it means to fully enjoy that good gift of being a good husband and a good father without Jesus, because there's a completeness there. There's a fulfillment there. Husbands, we won't fully understand what it means for two to become one without Jesus. Like, we can love our spouses, we can be great husbands, but there's a completeness that Jesus brings. I think the Hebrew word is like dode. It's pretty cool. It's this mingling of souls. Without Jesus, we won't understand that level of satisfaction. I truly believe that deep down we have a longing for something greater. We do. So we try to fill that chasm, that crater, with more and more and more and more. And many people will spend their entire lives trying to fill that longing. And Jesus says, come to me and never thirst again. So this is my prayer for you this morning. If you have been searching and searching and searching and trying and trying and trying, will you now come to Jesus and never thirst again? For the believers in the room, look, I get it. We get off track, okay? Like, we need this reminder. We still live in a fallen, broken world. We forget this satisfaction that only comes through Jesus, right? There's a reason, musicians, right? You tune your guitar not once a month. Right? Like, you tune your guitar before every song. Why? Because your guitar gets out of tune. Our hearts get out of tune. Right? We need this reminder that nothing this world has to offer can ultimately satisfy. So Christians in the room, this is your reminder today. Here's what I want us to do. We're gonna enter into a time of prayer, and we're gonna reflect on these first 11 verses of Ecclesiastes chapter 2, and really we can reflect on all of Ecclesiastes right now. But I also want us to do this because I know like a message like this sounds good. You're like, yeah, more of Jesus, less of everything else. But it's like, what does that mean? Right? Like, how do I practically apply a message like this to my life? So here's what I want us to do. I want you to think of one thing. I don't know what your thing is, okay? I want you to think of one thing that you can do this week to pursue Jesus harder. I don't know what that thing is. Maybe that's what you're going to pray about right now. Maybe you've been coming to Lakeview for 6 weeks, 6 months, 6 years, and you've never joined a home group, right? Maybe this week, that's your thing. I'm going to pray about joining a home group at Lakeview Church. Maybe your thing is reading your Bible. Like, I know I should be. I just haven't been. Maybe your thing this week is, you know what? I'm going to get into a Bible reading plan. Maybe like me, you, the one thing that I've been trying to focus on over the last few weeks is dedicated times of prayer, right? Like, very simple, but like blocking out specific times where I'm going to spend time alone with the Lord. Maybe that's your one thing. So here's what I want us to do now. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer. I want you to pray about that one step you're going to take this week to pursue Jesus harder. And I also want you to reflect. Like, reflect on Ecclesiastes. If you're not a believer in this room, will you ask Jesus now in this moment to radically change your life? And if you are a believer, I want you to pray about that one thing. And I want you, maybe this is a time for repentance and confession for you because you know your heart's out of tune. Will you go to the Lord in prayer now? God, you know so many of us are on that treadmill right now. We're just going day after day after day, trying to find meaning, trying to find purpose. Jesus, thank you for this reminder this morning that without you, there is no purpose. You provide the meaning and the satisfaction and the longing. You are the reason we ultimately get to enjoy the good things that our Heavenly Father has given us. So God, I'm asking you right now, if there's anybody here in this room, listening to the podcast, watching online, that does not know you, that feels like their life has been nothing but an endless pursuit of meaning and purpose and satisfaction, it is my prayer that right now, Holy Spirit, you would press upon their hearts their need for a Savior. If that's you in this room right now, will you cry out to God? Will you even now ask Him to fill that longing deep in your soul? Will you cry out to Jesus and tell Him that you are a sinner in need of a Savior? Scripture is very clear here that if we confess with our hearts that Jesus is Lord, we believe that God raised Him from the dead, we will be saved. I believe God can save you right now. Got to lift up the believers in this room who are in need of a little bit of a tune-up. God, you know we live in a broken and fallen world, and sometimes the things of this world get in the way of what we're ultimately supposed to be doing. That's seeking hard after you. So God, thank you for this reminder today. God, we do thank you for the incredible gifts that you've blessed us with. Will you forgive us for elevating those gifts to a place of supremacy when that place is reserved for you, King Jesus? God, will you work and move in a mighty way in our hearts and in our lives this week? And will you press upon us what that one thing is this week? What is that one thing, God? It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. It's a great Sunday. The first Sunday of the month, we get to participate in the ordinance of the Lord's Supper, communion, but it's not just that today. You know what's even better than back-to-back baptism Sundays? Back-to-back-to-back baptism Sundays. We've got another baptism right after our service this morning, so we're gonna take communion. KJ, we're so excited for you. We're going to take communion, we're going to sing a song, and then you guys are going to sit down, and we're going to celebrate, and we're going to party, because Jesus is changing lives right here at Lakeview Church. I want us to hear the words of our Lord Jesus Christ as they are delivered by the Apostle Paul. For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Will you take of the loaf now? In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Will you take of the cup? Let's pray. Jesus, your body was broken for us, your blood shed for the forgiveness of our sins. And Jesus, you endured that. And I'm so thankful that you did not stay on the cross. You didn't stay in the grave. You rose from the grave. You conquered sin. You conquered death. You satisfied the very wrath of God that we might have a right relationship with our Heavenly Father. Jesus, this is all for you. Keep working, keep moving. mold, shape, change us. Jesus, we love you. We praise you. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
You stand with us and join in worship.
Church, you can have a seat just for a moment. Lakeview, this is Kadra Dial. Kadra, actually, she got saved at a pretty young age, but came to me this week. I her and her husband, Corey, they attended membership class. And he said, you know what? I need to tell the whole world that Jesus has radically changed my life. So Kadra, who's relatively shy, is here doing a very bold thing right now and standing in front of you to say, Jesus has changed my life. I want the world to know what he's done. So we're so excited to celebrate with you, Kadra. So I just have one question to ask. Who is your Lord and Savior?
Jesus Christ.
Kadra, it's based on your profession of faith that I baptize you, my sister in Christ, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of Christ's death, raised to walk in newness of life. Lakeview Church, this is why we do what we do each and every week, to continue celebrating what Jesus is doing amongst his people. Will you now go in the grace and knowledge and peace that can only come from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ? Will you go in grace and peace? Amen.